today can be found in Matthew chapter 13, verses 31 to 32. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man took and planted in his field. Though it is the smallest of all seeds, yet when it grows, it is the largest of garden plants and becomes a tree, so that the birds come and perch in its branches. May the Lord bless the blessing. I'm leading it this way.
For those who have good memories, you'll remember that 4 weeks ago, I had started a series on the first letter to the Corinthians. Then we had a special meeting with the forum, and then the following week, we focused on the resurrection. Last week, I was away. So I want to take up where we left off. Corinthians part 2, lessons from rowdy Christians. Just to give you a reminder, there's a big number of issues in the letter to the Corinthians. And as I said, I'm not going to go through every one, but just take what kind of strikes me as being important. And this week, I want to focus on a theme that's not really developed in the book, but there's a one couple of words right at the beginning that raise an issue that I think all of us have to face in our interaction with people, you know, out in our daily lives. So today is not going to be a line-by-line exposition of the passage so much as a reflection on a common practical issue that we have to face. And it comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, right back at the beginning again. When I was preparing for the earlier message, I had been reading a number of different Bible translations, and I came across one that said this. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 2. The translations that I was studying at the time said, "I am writing this to God's church in Corinth, to you who have been called by God to be his own holy people." Now, in some of the more literal translations, it doesn't say it in quite those everyday words, but the idea is still there. But I was struck when I read that particular translation by the phrase, "God's own holy people." And I was thinking about this in the context of the letter that Paul was writing, what was going on in Corinth, and what the historical situation was. And this is what struck me. First of all, as you know, the church in Corinth was a vibrant, enthusiastic congregation of believers in Christ. But they had a lot of problems, serious moral problems, right? As well as disunity and factionalism. I mentioned that already. So I was thinking, here's this group that have all these problems, and yet in this translation, Paul describes them as if they are the only people in the world who happen to belong to God. You can almost make that argument, right? Then the other thing I thought about, at the time that Paul wrote this letter, not only were the Corinthians just a small congregation, maybe about the size of us, I don't know really, but the entire Christian presence in the world was minuscule. As we talked about, it came up in the Sabbath school class. The presence of Christians in the Roman Empire at that time was like a fingernail on the body. And yet, for their problems and for the small size, Paul described these believers in Corinth as if they alone were God's people. And it made me think of a question that we encounter a lot when we talk to people. Well, maybe not every day, but it comes up often when you have religious conversation with people is, are you saying that Christians are the only people that God is concerned about? Have you heard this question? You know, or some variation of that? Are you trying to tell me, Christian person, that only Christians have this pipeline to God? Nobody else in the world can be validated by God? Have you had a question like that or some variation? So I started to think about this, right? And that's what I want to focus on today. Again, I'm not going to go word by word through any one passage, but I wanted to reflect on how it could be that in past history, this little scattered group, scattered throughout Asia Minor, scattered throughout the Roman Empire, this group called Christians, how could it be that they could lay exclusive claim to being the people of God? Right? Think about it. Doesn't it seem kind of ridiculous if you think about it 2,000 years ago, that there's just this scattered group of peoples here and there, and yet they are considered God's people to the exclusion of everyone else? And even nowadays, in our present society, in which we live in what's known as a pluralist society, right? Where we are aware of all different beliefs and practices of the whole globe. Not like in the old ancient times where you just knew your own locale, right? Doesn't it sound kind of arrogant and somewhat closed-minded for us to make the claim that we're the only ones? So I wanted to ask about this question. That's the issue today. What is the relationship of God to other individuals in the world who are not Christian, number one, and to other religions in the world? That's what I want to analyze. So again, it's not a step-by-step analysis of a passage. It's but a reflection on what, to many people, is a burning question. As a matter of fact, just 2 weeks ago, a person who's older than I am, who's been a Christian for many decades, asked this question in a conversation. How should we relate to people of other religions? And how should we relate to other religions? And I can think back all the way to the late 1980s when I had a significant encounter that was important enough that I remembered it to this day. I'll tell you a little bit about it, but it had that same issue. When I graduated from college in 1986, I went to work with some of my fellow graduates with two churches in the East Bay area. That's across from San Francisco Bay, right? The area of Berkeley and Oakland. And I got settled in the community. You've heard me talk about this situation before. I rented a room in a house where we shared the common spaces. I had my own room, we shared the kitchen, the bathroom, and there were students there. But the owner of the house was a friend of mine named Jack, who I love, and I talked to you a little bit about Jack. He had had a PhD. He had also had a second degree. And we had a guest room in the house that was a small room right off the kitchen where some people that we knew, and especially his friends, would come and stay. So I'd wake up and I'd go down one day for breakfast and there'd be some PhD sitting there, you know, in psychology or some other field from Chicago or from Philadelphia. And we had very interesting conversations. So one Saturday morning, I came down dressed in a suit. And there was this fellow sitting there at the table. He says, "Hey, where are you going on a Saturday morning, all dressed up in a suit?" And I said, "I'm a Seventh-day Adventist, and I'm going to church." And we had this whole conversation. He was a very sweet man, I remember. You know, a very kind-hearted person. But he brought up this issue that I raised today. Right. He started asking a lot of different things about the Bible, like, how come there's so much violence? I don't think it's a good book for kids. I remember him saying that. And some other things, too. But the one issue that I remember the most is he's saying, Christians go around thinking like they're the only ones who God loves and has this exclusive claim to. So it is a common thing. And I wanted to address that today because it's something that I've had to deal with for decades already. And as I spent time reflecting on it, three different aspects of the problem came to mind. So I'm going to go through those one by one. They're not necessarily interconnected, although I think there's a way we can find some common ground. But let me tell you what I first came up with. So I was thinking again, what is God's relationship to the rest of the world? Especially, what is God's relationship to other religious people in the world, right? And especially now, where we live in society, like I say, there are a billion people in India, am I right? Many of them are religious. Can we say that God has written them all off just because they don't happen to know the formula, you know, of Jesus Christ that died for our sins? What can we do with this people, with these people, this idea? Because they were born in the wrong place? Does therefore God just say, well, I'm sorry, you know, you didn't get to hear, so therefore you're doomed to eternity, for eternity. Is that how it is? Are they all disqualified? Are all religious teachings invalid and futile? Now think about it. Should typical Christianity as we know it would say yes to those things, right? that there's no other way to heaven except through this one channel. And that the other religions are not just, you know, useless, they're actually, some might say, demonic and diversions. What do you think? Is that really the case? Does God say, well, I'm sorry, you know, you were born as a Hindu, or you were born as a Sikh, or as a Muslim in some other country, and that religion's no good, so sorry about that, but we will see you later. You know? Is that how it works? I'm not so comfortable with that. Although I do recognize the fact that the Bible makes specific claims for Christianity. So how do we balance these two things? First of all, I think you can tell from the way I present it, it doesn't seem reasonable that a reasonable, rational, good-hearted God would completely overlook a person's life, especially if they were good person, people, right? Just because they didn't happen to be in the right place at the right time, or because they didn't know the name of Jesus. But there are, aside from just the unreasonableness of that position, I can't just say, well, this doesn't make sense to me. As a person who believes in the Bible, I got to see, what does the Bible say about it, right? What does our tradition say about other religions and other people that have different outlooks? And I remembered some stories. I'm not going to look those up today, but in the Old Testament, you may remember that when King Solomon took his throne, he relied on this guy named Hiram of Tyre, who wasn't really a part of Israel. But yet, as you read the story, he did more good for Solomon than Solomon did for him. You know what I mean? In a way, you could read that story and see that there was this guy who was outside of the people of God, and yet was more righteous in his relationship with Solomon than vice versa. So there are hints in the Bible that God does care and reach out beyond just his little group. You know what I mean? And he does give validation to people who are living right in other positions and places. But in the New Testament, it comes out almost explicitly. If you take a look at the 10th chapter of Acts, this is where Peter is called to go eat with Cornelius and the rest of the Gentiles. Remember, as a Jewish person, not only was Peter not allowed to eat the food of Gentiles, he wasn't even allowed to eat with them, period. You know, and in some places, I've even seen it nowadays, you're not even allowed to touch what they touch, you know? So this is the framework that Peter was in. And you remember he had that dream about the unclean animals coming down on the sheep, and he was convinced to go visit the house of Cornelius. And as the story unfolds, Peter at first is like wondering, what am I doing here? He asks Cornelius, why did you call me? Cornelius says, I had a vision that said to go call you. And, you know, I'm sure Peter got very intrigued by that. Oh, wow, this guy had a vision to call me. And Peter starts telling him the story of Jesus. You know how it goes. I'm sure you're familiar with the story. And Peter makes this comment in verse 34, chapter 10, verse 34. Get this. Opening his mouth, Peter said, I most certainly understand now that God is not one to show partiality. But in every nation, you get that? In every nation, the man who fears him and does what is right is welcome to him. Now, I didn't say that. Peter said that in his speech, right? He said, I see that God doesn't have these barriers and limits and show favoritism only to one group. But if somebody does what's right and has respect toward him, what does it say? Who fears him and does what is right, God welcomes that person. Says it right there. That seems to suggest that God really is concerned about the moral quality of people, right? On their own terms. Not just, well, you happen to know the name of Jesus, or you didn't happen to know the name of Jesus, so therefore you're either in or out. No, God can look at a person's life, look at what they're made of, and make a decision. Hey, what type of person is this? Is this a good person? Is this a person that I can welcome, and can I affirm? It seems to suggest that, right? Now, I know what you're thinking. I'm going to guess already. It's a very integral part of Christian teaching as we know it, that we are not saved by works, but by faith. right? This is something that I'm sure is in not just the back of your minds, but the front of your mind, if that's such an expression, right? You're all thinking, well, wait a minute, Pastor. If God can look at people on the basis of who they are, how they live, what type of people they are, and either affirm them or not, then isn't that a contradiction to the teaching that we say you're only saved by faith? All right, we'll keep that in mind. But I want to go to one of the books, the next book, Romans. Romans chapter 2. Of all the books in the Bible that emphasize the idea of righteousness by faith rather than righteousness by works, Romans is one of the top two. And look what Paul says there. In chapter 2, In chapter 1, Paul had been describing the type of people that were, in terms that were the common description of Gentiles. In the Jewish world, in the ancient world, the Jewish people felt like they were the insiders, and they were. And that they had superior moral teachings, and there was a certain stock description of Gentiles as being, you know, not caring about God, being caught up in all kinds of divergent lifestyles and practices. So in chapter 1, Paul describes the world in terms that any Jewish reader would recognize as, hey, Paul's describing them, not us, right? So this is, he used stock, almost like stock photography or stock footage, right? Stock copy to describe what Jewish people would clearly recognize as Gentiles. But if you look at chapter 2, he turns the tables. At the beginning of chapter 2, he says, therefore, you have no excuse, every one of you who is passing judgment now, for in that which you judge another, you condemn yourself. So in other words, Paul is almost setting them up. This group of people in the past who were self-righteous, he's saying, okay, you think those people are pretty bad? Well, guess what? If you had a mirror, you would find out that some of you are doing the same types of things. So he wants to level the playing field. I'm giving you a quick synopsis of the first two chapters of Romans, so we can get to this passage that is relevant to our topic. In verse 5, in the middle of Paul's argument, he says, because of your stubbornness and unrepentant heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. Okay, so now he's going to talk about how God goes about making judgment. And he says, who will render to each person according to his deeds? You see that?
Yeah.
He's talking, remember the audience here. He's not talking about a grand theological theme of righteousness by works or righteousness by faith. He's talking to a group of people who feel that on the basis of their lineage, just because of who they are, and because they possess the covenant of law, they are automatically insiders. He's saying, no, it doesn't quite work that way. He says, God will judge to each, render to each person according to his deeds. To those, verse 7, who by perseverance in doing good seek for glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. But to those who are selfishly ambitious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, he will apportion wrath and indignation. Then he goes on to say, there will be tribulation and distress for every soul of man who does evil, of the Jew first and also of the Greek. But glory and honor and peace to everyone who does good, to the Jew first and also to the Greek, for there is no partiality with God. You see that? So it would seem to suggest that God is a pretty reasonable person, that he could look at each individual, no matter where they are in the world, assess the quality of their nature, assess how it comes out in practice, and he's wise enough to say, hey, this person may not be in my group, so to speak, but I can confirm that person's validity. It would seem to suggest that. Now, like I said, this causes us to run into the problem of works versus faith. But if you remember where we started in 2016, looking at the letter to the Galatians, the whole issue of works versus faith was not applying to everybody in the whole world. It was applying to what was going on at the time. On what basis could Gentiles enter into the people of God? Was it on the basis of having to do the works of the law, in other words, get circumcised and enter into that covenant? Or was it on the basis of faith in Christ? So just keep the context in mind. What I'm trying to say here is that when it comes to God looking out beyond his own people, what other criteria can he have than to look at the quality of the type of person they are. If they have really never had the opportunity
right.
to know the formula, I call it the formula, because that's the way some people treat it, right? If you know the formula, I'm a sinner, Jesus died for my sins, I can be forgiven, then great. You know, but what if you never had that, had access to that? How else is God going to know what to do with you? You see what I'm saying? And these two passages clearly bring that out, idea out. If we are not going to accept that, then we have two shortcomings in our theory. The first shortcoming is that we have an inadequate way of evaluating other people.
Right.
You know what I mean? If all we can say is, well, either you believe in Christ or not, then that completely minimizes the existential reality of people's entire lifestyle, which could be lives, which could be 60 or 80 years. We discount whatever they did for the decades of their life because we have a formula that says, well, too bad you didn't believe it so long. So it's an inadequate way of judging individuals. The thing that's even worse is it puts a low estimate of God on God. God is not wise enough to know the difference between people. You know what I mean? It's not really a good formula. So God is not wise enough to judge the quality of people but has to rely on a formula. This is what I was thinking. Remember, the question I asked was this. Can we say that we have exclusive rights to God on the basis of the fact that we were privileged to know about Jesus?
Yeah.
Or does God have access to other people as well? Does God even have access to other people in the context of their religion?
Yes.
It's the bigger question. So what I'm saying, the first thought that came to me is there's indication in the Bible that God does indeed judge people on the basis of their quality, not just on whether or not they knew a certain piece of information.
Right.
Number one. But then I got to thinking about the second one. Remember, moving on to point two. It's not exactly connected. But I had been raising the question to myself on the basis of the size of the church when Paul wrote his letter. What could there have been? A few thousand Christians maybe in the Roman Empire outside of the Palestine? You know, outside of the Hebrew nation? How, I was thinking, how could such a minuscule group earn this title of being the exclusive people of God? In other words, I was basing my answer on the size of the group. But then it occurred to me that maybe size is not the criterion. And I remembered a technical term from my health studies. There's something called the blastula. Do you remember what that term was? The blastula? Maybe Nora will remember, because she's a nurse. When a human person is conceived, it starts off with an egg and a sperm, right? And then it's conceived and it starts to multiply. That first few days when it's only a multicellular organism is called a blastula, right? But what happens to a blastula over time? It gets bigger and bigger. It grows into a fetus. And then it grows into a fully formed infant. It's birthed. And then 21 more years go by and you're actually a fully formed adult. So I was thinking to myself, well, maybe the church, as Paul knew it, was indeed the real holy people of God, the exclusive people of God, not because they were big, but because they were the germ. They were like the seed of something that would grow bigger.
Right.
Right? So it wasn't a matter of size. It was a matter of identity that would start to grow. And then I remembered something. I said, hey, I don't need to talk about a blastula. There's an image in the Bible itself. We read it for the scripture reading. Matthew 13, verses 31, or 30, whatever verse it was, 31 and 32. It says, Jesus presented another parable to them. And he said, the kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field. And this is smaller than all other seeds. But when it is full grown, it is larger than the garden plants and becomes a tree so that the birds of the air can nest in its branches. This is Jesus' own image. The church is not what it is because of its size. The church is not uniquely God's people because it's the full-fledged outcome, fully grown plant,
right?
It is because it's a start. In other words, the church is what it is because it's a process. And here's the interesting thing. I'm going to take a break from my 3 points here to give some application already. Think about this. If it's true that what Jesus started 2,000 years ago is the people of God, and it's been going through this process of growth, like a blastula or like a mustard seed, right? Then what that means for us, that gives us a sense of who we are. A lot of times when we think about what it makes a Christian, in our day and age, everything is present, everything is personal. We think a person becomes a Christian when they have this, you know, insight into God, when they give their life to God, that moment, and then it has no historical connection at all necessarily. Just an individual thing that happens to a person sometime in their lives, right? But if you start to think of the church as this long-term process that's been going through history and growing and developing, then that gives us a different definition of what it means to be a Christian. What it means to be a Christian is a person who made the decision to join up with that movement that started 2,000 years ago. You see what I mean? There's a historicity to it. In our view of religion, it's all either present or future, right? Especially for Seventh-day Adventists, which is built into our name, the idea that we're waiting for something to happen in the future, right? It's almost as if we just plop out of space without no history, and we're here and we're moving and looking ahead.
Right.
But if you start to get the vision of what the church is, this plant that was planted 2,000 years ago and has been growing and spreading, then our identity is not just based on our first experience, our personal experience. It's not just based on where we're going, but it's like, hey, we are part of that. We are part of that movement that started all that long time ago. And not only do we identify with the movement, but we identify with the teachings of the movement, right? That's who we are. So, I already indicated, there's another way to think about this. This view of the church, this view of why the church is special, can help us to see that our religion is not just focused on the present and the future, but it's connected to a long-standing thing that's been rolling through 2 millennia already. It's not just about what God will do one day, but it's what God has done in the past and is still doing. And the last thing that I think I like about this view, if we could see the church, the specialness of the church, is that it was planted by Jesus. It has a certain character quality. It's been rolling through the ages. And that means that our lives now, our real lives in the world, every day, is religious. It's not just like we have this separate spirituality that has nothing to do with real life, and that's just looking forward to some special supernatural intervention that will happen later. The whole thing is in history now, and we're hooking up with it and becoming part of it.
Experience. Yeah.
So that was the second thing. I took a little diversion there. The second thing I thought about, how could Paul say that this little group of people were the exclusive people of God? Well, the mustard seed image is why. It's not a matter of size. It's a matter of identity and characteristic. Then I thought about something else a couple of days later. Not only did God do something new in Christ, and that those tiny congregations in Asia Minor were now part of that new planting, right? But I got to thinking about it. That even that had a history. Jesus and his movement came out of Judaism, right? Which was going back 1,500 years at least. So even in that regard, it wasn't just a brand new thing that sprang out of nowhere. The Christian experience is the development of Judaism, and as Paul used it, even the Gentiles who were brought in were grafted in to a tree that had already been there, right? And the thing that I like about this image is, in regard to the question I'm asking, how can Christians make the claim that we are the ones that have it all right and, you know, the rest of the world is all wrong? If we think in terms of us joining up with the movement of Israel through the decades and through the centuries,
right,
they were in relationship with a specific God. Remember, there were lots of gods over there in their time, right, at that time. There were many gods. Every tribe and every area of the globe had its own god or gods. We, the Jewish people, were in relationship with a specific god.
Yes.
In English, we translate the name Jehovah. Sometimes it's Yahweh. But the fact of the matter is nobody knows how the name was supposed to be pronounced. You know why? Because the Jewish people, through the centuries, have felt like the name was so holy that they couldn't even say it. In the Old Testament, where that phrase came up, YHVH or whatever,
right?
They put Lord God, or they put Adonai, because they felt like God's name was so holy we can't even speak it. And even now, Jewish people won't do it. They call it Hashem. I don't know if you heard that term. It means the name. That's what they say. When they talk about God, they say the name, because they won't say the name. So, whatever the case may be, the point is this. God's people can be called God's people, not based on their size, not even based necessarily on their quality, because we're all at different stages, right? We're God's people because we're in relationship with this particular God, the God of the Jewish people. We're part of this tradition that had been going back to the time of Abraham. All right, now, so those are the three things that I came up with in my reflection on this topic. What does that mean? How can we pull those all together? First of all, as I said at the beginning, Christians are the people of God, not because God cannot reach anybody else in the world. See, this is what I'm thinking now. Christians are the people of God, not because God is incapable of reaching other individuals, or even working within their system of religion, whatever that is, or culture. That's not the reason why God is the God of Christians. But rather, God, we can say that we are the people of God because we are part of something that began in a new way 2,000 years ago. It has a certain characteristic and quality. And yet, it even goes back before that. Judaism was in a relationship with this particular God, Yahweh, Hashem, whatever we want to call it, say it. It wasn't with Baal or Baal. It wasn't with Marduk. They were in a relationship with the person they understood that created the whole universe, who was intent to save human beings, and who actually was a Lord of love and commitment. This vision tells us who we are. We are God's people because we're people in that tradition. We are identified with a long past, going back before Jesus, but most especially revealed in the person of Jesus. So, what this suggests is this. The most important reason that we are the people of God is not size, it's not even necessarily the length of the history. There's some other quality that makes Christians the unique people of God. And I think the best way I can explain it is by a story. When I lived in Thailand, there was a pastor there who had been grown up in India. I don't think he was functioning as a pastor at the time. I think he had, to survive and feed his family, and he had some other job. I don't even know. Pastor Aurora was his name. He had been raised in a Hindu culture. He was living in a Buddhist culture. And when I found out he was a Christian pastor, I asked him one day, I said, "Why is it that you decided to become a Christian?" And I thought he was going to give me a big theological explanation. One sentence, he said, "Because there's nobody else like Jesus." He said, "There's never been anybody else like Jesus. I have high regard for the Buddhist faith because I lived among them. And as I've said before, their way of thinking is so different from ours that you can almost not even say that we're competition. You know what I mean? It's just two different ways of looking at the world." So I never felt like I was in competition with them. I could just appreciate what they do. You know what I mean? So I'm not here to denounce somebody else's religion, but I agree with Pastor Aurora. There's no other God in history that I know of that went to the cross after a life of loving service, right, that came down from heaven to become a human being, lived in complete dedication to God and to other people to the extent of dying on the cross to save people and reconcile them back to God. There's no other teaching about God like that. Most other teachings about God have God as the great thing in heaven that never can suffer, that can never be changed, that can never lose. You know what I mean? So I think Pastor Aurora is right. Why is it that Christians can say that we are the people of God? Not because of their size, and it's not because God can't work through other places. It's because we're in a relationship with this particular God. We're in a relationship with the God who was revealed through Jesus Christ, the Creator and the Savior who saved us by sacrifice. There's no other God like that. So, if I had to wrap it all up, I will affirm what I said at the beginning. I don't think God excludes people just on the basis of their historical situation. That's just an accident. So I was born in the United States. I was born in a Christian culture, so I'm lucky. Whereas somebody who was born somewhere else, well, too bad for them. I don't think it works like that. God is big enough and God is wise enough to identify who is real and who the quality of individuals, no matter what faith system they're in, no matter what culture they're in. That's the first thing. We, the church, can say that they are the unique people of God, however, even though they're small like they were at the beginning, even though we're flawed like we still are, because of the tradition that we have hooked up with. We have hooked up with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The God who was faithful to a specific group of people. The God who has a certain set of teachings and values and principles. And the God who manifested in Jesus Christ and went down to the cross. That's why. That's why we can say, we are God's people. Because we know this God. Doesn't mean I have to argue against everybody else who believes something else. But we can go out into the world and say, this is the God we know. We are His people. He's planted this mustard seed 2,000 years ago. We're part of the process. So let me wrap it up by finishing the story I told you at the beginning. That PhD that I had the conversation with in my friend Jack's house, there's more to the story. When he told me that his biggest gripe against Christianity was the idea that Christians say we are it and everybody else is doomed. Everybody else is going to the hot place, right? Because they don't happen to know the right formula. When he said that, I told him, in response, I said, that's not what I believe. And that's not what the Seventh-day Adventist Church teaches either, by the way. I'm not sure if you know that. I said, I believe God is able to work and understand people within their own context, based on the quality of their lives. And I could see his face and his muscles just relax. You know, he was in an aggressive posture before that. But when I said that, everything relaxed. And he was a lot more open to hearing and allowing for Christianity, I should say. He said, so you believe God can work outside of the bounds of Christianity? I said, yes. But then he asked a very interesting question. A very logical question. Can you guess what it was? He said, well, if God can save people in wherever they are, in whichever system, then why do you go around preaching and trying to convert people? It's a good question, right? Why should we go and turn people's worlds upside down, force them to change from their whole culture, sometimes separate from their friends, if God can save them right then and there? It's a good question, right?
Yes.
What would you say? Do you know? What do you think I said? You know what I told him? I said, the reason we go and preach is not because God can't save you. It's because God has started this project, and He wants to get more people in on it. God started this project in Christ 2,000 years ago to bring the world into unity and love, and to instill in people not just good moral principles, but the very spirit of Jesus Christ, of service. I said, yeah, God can save people no matter what level of information they have, no matter where they are. But God's got a project going. He's trying to accomplish something. Right. He's trying to establish the kingdom of God.
Right.
So we go and we tell people, hey, God has revealed Himself in Jesus Christ as this type of person. Do you want to join us?
Amen.
See, that's a different reason altogether. It respects people's experience, and yet it preserves the uniqueness. There really is no God like Jesus.
Amen.
There really is no picture of God like the one revealed in Christ. At least I've never heard of one that actually comes down, served, washed people's feet, and then died to establish relationships. God wants to create a whole world that runs by that spirit. That's why, as small as those Corinthians were, and as crazy as they were, you know, when you read their story, they were part of that seed. They were like the first sprout, right, of that seed that was to grow around the world.
Right.
This is who we are. We're part of that process. That's our identity, and that's our project. We're here to be part of that project of God instilling into the world this special and unique view of who He is and what life is all about. And I'll tell you one thing in closing, and maybe some of you will be mad at me about this. I don't know. Maybe you're mad at me already. I don't know. I really, as a pastor even, and as a Christian, I have no great desire to go and tell everybody else how much better we are than them. I have no desire in the world to try to go and persuade everybody, anybody else, that my way is right and their way is wrong. I really don't. What I have a commitment to do is to live this life and to talk to people and say, you know what? You have your beliefs in God. Good. Tell me about those. Now let me tell you about my God. Just let them know. Just let them know. I'm not going to judge them for their beliefs. But when I have the opportunity, I'm going to say, this is who we know. Yeah. This is the God we know. Yeah. Because I keep in mind that mustard seed. We are the mustard seed people. We are the mustard seed people. We are part of that plant that God planted. And we're part of a tradition that goes back before that. We are friends of God. We are friends of a particular kind of God. We are friends of the God that went to the cross. And in that regard, maybe that's the only way we can say, you know what, we really are God's special people because we know the real God. And our job is to bring that God to the world.
Amen.